Project Jurisprudence on YouTube.
Rule 130. Rules of admissibility. See testimonial evidence. 1. Qualification of witnesses. Section 20. Witnesses, their qualifications. Except as provided in the next succeeding section, all persons who can perceive, and perceiving, can make their known perception to others, may be witnesses. Religious or political belief, interest in the outcome of the case, or conviction of a crime, unless otherwise provided by law, shall not be ground for disqualification. Section 21. Disqualification by reason of mental incapacity or immaturity. The following persons cannot be witnesses. A. Those whose mental condition, at the time of their production for examination, is such that they are incapable of intelligently making known their perception to others. B. Children whose mental maturity is such as to render them incapable of perceiving the facts respecting which they are examined and of relating them truthfully. Section 22. Disqualification by reason of marriage. During their marriage, neither the husband nor the wife may testify for or against the other without the consent of the affected spouse, except in a civil case by one against the other, or in a criminal case for a crime committed by one against the other, or the latter's direct descendants or ascendants. Section 23. Disqualification by reason of death or insanity of adverse party. Parties or senior of parties to a case, or persons in whose behalf a case is prosecuted, against an executor or administrator or other representative of a deceased person, or against a person of unsound mind, upon a claim or demand against the estate of such deceased person or against such person of unsound mind, cannot testify as to any matter of fact occurring before the death of such deceased person or before such person became of unsound mind. Section 24. Disqualification by reason of privileged communication. The following persons cannot testify as to matters learned in confidence in the following cases. A. The husband or the wife, during or after the marriage, cannot be examined without the consent of the other as to any communication received in confidence by one from the other during the marriage except in a civil case by one against the other, or in a criminal case for a crime committed by one against the other, or the latter's direct descendants or ascendants. B. An attorney cannot, without the consent of his client, be examined as to any communication made by the client to him, or his advice given thereon in the course of, or with a view to, professional employment, nor can an attorney's secretary, stenographer, or clerk be examined, without the consent of the client and his employer, concerning any fact the knowledge of which has been acquired in such capacity. C. A person authorized to practice medicine, surgery or obstetrics cannot in a civil case, without the consent of the patient, be examined as to any advice or treatment given by him or any information which he may have acquired in attending such patient in a professional capacity, which information was necessary to enable him to act in capacity, and which would blacken the reputation of the patient. D. A minister or priest cannot, without the consent of the person making the confession, be examined as to any confession made to or any advice given by him in his professional character in the course of discipline enjoined by the church to which the minister or priest belongs. E. A public officer cannot be examined during his term of office or afterwards, as to communications made to him in official confidence, when the court finds that the public interest would suffer by the disclosure. 2. Testimonial privilege. Section 25. Parental and filial privilege. No person may be compelled to testify against his parents, other direct descendants, children or other direct descendants. 3. Admissions and confessions. Section 26. Admission of a party. The act, declaration or omission of a party as to a relevant fact may be given in evidence against him. Section 27. Offer of compromise not admissible. In civil cases, an offer of compromise is not an admission of any liability, and is not admissible in evidence against the offerer. In criminal cases, except those involving quasi-offenses, criminal negligence, or those allowed by law to be compromised, an offer of compromise by the accused may be received in evidence as an implied admission of guilt. A plea of guilty later withdrawn, or an unaccepted offer of a plea of guilty to lesser offense, is not admissible in evidence against the accused who made the plea or offer. An offer to pay or the payment of medical, hospital or other expenses occasioned by an injury is not admissible in evidence as proof of civil or criminal liability for the injury. Section 28. Admission by third party. The rights of a party cannot be prejudiced by an act, declaration, or omission of another, except as herein after provided. Section 29. Admission by co-partner or agent. The act or declaration of a partner or agent of the party within the scope of his authority and during the existence of the partnership or agency, may be given in evidence against such party after the partnership or agency is shown by evidence other than such act or declaration. The same rule applies to the act or declaration of a joint owner, joint debtor, or other person jointly interested with the party. Section 30. Admission by conspirator. The act or declaration of a conspirator relating to the conspiracy and during its existence may be given in evidence against the co-conspirator after the conspiracy is shown by evidence other than such act of declaration. Section 31. Admission by privies. Where one derives title to property from another, the act, declaration, or omission of the latter, while holding the title, in relation to the property, is evidence against the former. Section 32. Admission by silence. An act or declaration made in the presence and within the hearing or observation of a party who does or says nothing when the act or declaration is such as naturally to call for action or comment if not true, and when proper and possible for him to do so, may be given in evidence against him. Section 33. Confession. The declaration of an accused acknowledging his guilt of the offense charged, or of any offense necessarily included therein, may be given in evidence against him. 4. Previous conduct as evidence. Section 34. Similar acts as evidence. Evidence that one did or did not do a certain thing at one time is not admissible to prove that he did or did not do the same or similar thing at another time. But it may be received to prove a specific intent or knowledge. Identity, plan, system, scheme, habit, custom or usage, and the like. Section 35. An accepted offer. An offer in writing to pay a particular sum of money or to deliver a written instrument or specific personal property is, if rejected without valid cause, equivalent to the actual production and tender of the money, instrument, or property. 5. Testimonial knowledge. Section 36. Testimony generally confined to personal knowledge. Hearsay excluded. A witness can testify only to those facts which he knows of his personal knowledge. That is, which are derived from his own perception, except as otherwise provided in these rules. 6. Exceptions to the hearsay rule. Section 37. Dying declaration. The declaration of a dying person, made under the consciousness of an impending death, may be received in any case wherein his death is the subject of inquiry, as evidence of the cause and surrounding circumstances of such death. Section 38. Declaration against interest. The declaration made by a person deceased, or unable to testify, against the interest of the declarant, if the fact is asserted in the declaration was at the time it was made so far contrary to declarant's own interest, that a reasonable man in his position would not have made the declaration unless he believed it to be true, may be received in evidence against himself or his successors in interest and against third persons. Section 39. Act or declaration about pedigree. The act or declaration of a person deceased, or unable to testify, in respect to the pedigree of another person related to him by birth or marriage, may be received in evidence where it occurred before the controversy, and the relationship between the two persons is shown by evidence other than such act or declaration. The word pedigree includes relationship, family genealogy, birth, marriage, death, the dates when and the places where these fast occurred, and the names of the relatives. It embraces also facts of family history intimately connected with pedigree. Section 40. Family reputation or tradition regarding pedigree. The reputation or tradition existing in a family previous to the controversy, in respect to the pedigree of any one of its members, may be received in evidence if the witness testifying thereon be also a member of the family, either by consanguinity or affinity. Entries in family Bibles or other family books or charts, engravings on rings, family portraits and the like, may be received as evidence of pedigree. Section 41. Common reputation. Common reputation existing previous to the controversy, respecting facts of public or general interest more than 30 years old, or respecting marriage or moral character, may be given in evidence. Monuments and inscriptions in public places may be received as evidence of common reputation. Section 42. Part of res gestae. Statements made by a person while a starting occurrence is taking place or immediately prior or subsequent thereto with respect to the circumstances thereof, may be given in evidence as part of res gestae. So, also, statements accompanying an equivocal act material to the issue, and giving it a legal significance, may be received as part of the res gestae. Section 43. Entries in the course of business. Entries made at, or near the time of transactions to which they refer, by a person deceased, or unable to testify, who was in a position to know the facts therein stated, may be received as prima facie evidence, if such person made the entries in his professional capacity or in the performance of duty and in the ordinary or regular course of business or duty. Section 44. Entries in official records. Entries in official records made in the performance of his duty by a public officer of the Philippines, or by a person in the performance of a duty specially enjoined by law, are prima facie evidence of the facts therein stated. 38. Section 45. Commercial lists and the like. Evidence of statements of matters of interest to persons engaged in an occupation contained in a list, register, periodical, or other published compilation is admissible as tending to prove the truth of any relevant matter so stated if that compilation is published for use by persons engaged in that occupation and is generally used and relied upon by them therein. Section 46. Learned treatises. A published treatise, periodical or pamphlet on a subject of history, law, science, or art is admissible as tending to prove the truth of a matter stated therein if the court takes judicial notice, or a witness expert in the subject testifies, that the writer of the statement in the treatise, periodical or pamphlet is recognized in his profession or calling as expert in the subject. Section 47. Testimony or deposition at a former proceeding. The testimony or deposition of a witness deceased or unable to testify, given in a former case or proceeding, judicial or administrative, involving the same parties and subject matter, may be given in evidence against the adverse party who had the opportunity to cross-examine him. 7. Opinion Rule. Section 48. General Rule. The opinion of witness is not admissible, except as indicated in the following sections. Section 49. Opinion of expert witness. The opinion of a witness on a matter requiring special knowledge, skill, experience or training which he shown to possess, may be received in evidence. Section 50. Opinion of ordinary witnesses. The opinion of a witness for which proper basis is given, may be received in evidence regarding A. the identity of a person about whom he has adequate knowledge. B. a handwriting with which he has sufficient familiarity. And C. the mental sanity of a person with whom he is sufficiently acquainted. The witness may also testify on his impressions of the emotion, behavior, condition or appearance of a person. 8. Character Evidence. Section 51. Character evidence not generally admissible. Exceptions. A. In criminal cases, 1. The accused may prove his good moral character which is pertinent to the moral trait involved in the offense charged. 2. Unless in rebuttal, the prosecution may not prove his bad moral character which is pertinent to the moral trait involved in the offense charged. 3. The good or bad moral character of the offended party may be proved if it tends to establish in any reasonable degree the probability or improbability of the offense charged. B. In civil cases, evidence of the moral character of a party in civil cases is admissible only when pertinent to the issue of character involved in the case. C. In the case provided for in Rule 132, Section 14.
Project Jurisprudence on YouTube.